source, and then the yang source.
The yang.
And we think it's from the northern and southern kingdom. I feel like having two sources makes a lot of sense, just at least for my thing, because like you get stories that are like similar and then different. But then you get the question of, well, did both of these happen? Did one of these happen?
Well, I don't think it was the case that there was that source, but it's not, in terms of trying to discern them out of the text, but with this, to set up, you see, the strange paradigm.
It came from terms of God and like writing style, because I think Elois is thought to be a people that was like writing in a much more literal sense. Well, the Yahweh source was writing much more plainly. And it makes sense for like things when it's like, why do we have two creation accounts that are like mostly the same? But interesting. Or you know, you have the Baptist church thing, which is think harder. It's all, but it was a
Trinity Church. It's wonderful to see all of you here today. Please join us in the parish hall for coffee hour after the liturgy today. We will have Christian education today, so adult Sunday school starting at 11:30 in the parish hall. There will be a continuing in our exploration of the apocryphal or deuteronomical books of the Old Testament today with Tobit. And then the children will be upstairs in the annex. It looked like they will be talking about our gospel reading, which services as usual on Tuesday and Thursday. Just a reminder, the binder for the necrology is in the back, so any of the departed whom you'd like us to remember at the altar on All Saints Sunday, please put their names in that binder. Anyway.
We will be going on the 26th, which is a Saturday.
27th, or is it
Christmas? To clean up the highway. We have a few people who have expressed an interest, but we certainly have room for more, just as many as possible. That'll start around 9:30, and the Isotrakers have graciously offered to give everyone lunch after we finish picking up the debris, so that will be...
And washing it.
Father John and Andy for last Sunday with the blessing of the animals. My daughter Josie has been well behaved since then. So I'd like to thank Father John and Andy St. Francis for that. And then also would like to thank somebody for the beautiful Grand Slam home run for the Guardians.
Thank you.
Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. For we have not a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who, in every respect, has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And they were exceedingly astonished, and said to him, Then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, With men it is impossible, but not with God. For all things are possible with God. Peter began to say to him, Lo, we have left everything and followed you. Jesus said, Truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house, or brothers, or sisters, or mother, or father, or children, or lands, for my sake and for the gospel, who will not receive 100-fold now in this time, houses, and brothers, and sisters, and mother, and children, and lands, with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many that are first will be last, and the last first. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Two points about this morning's gospel really struck me for the first time. That's how wonderful the Bible is. I can be 40 years old and a priest for, 15, 16 years and still be surprised by the scripture. Now, these were not insights gained through my normal means of sermon preparation. I typically first consult patristic commentaries, that is, the reflections of the church fathers in the first few centuries of Christian history. Perhaps the most well-used books in my office, aside from the Bible and the prayer book, would be my 28-volume set of patristic Bible commentaries. There's also a lectionary podcast from a couple of priests, and a lectionary blog from a seminary dean I subscribe to that regularly help me look at the lessons in a different way. This week, though, it was in discussing the gospel lesson with Anne, who pointed out a couple of things that had not really occurred to me, and which I was shocked to find had not occurred to the church fathers in my books either. First, before this hard commandment to the rich young ruler, he's just called a man in the version we heard today, but in Luke and Matthew, he's identified as a ruler, to sell his possessions and give the money to the poor, we are told that Jesus, looking upon him, loved him. While wealth can certainly create moral and spiritual difficulty, Jesus is not here playing into an eat-the-rich mentality. As a preacher, some of you know, I'm often frustrated with some of my colleagues, and particularly those who came up during a certain period in the 20th century, in which the modus operandi was to preach more about social and political issues than about the heart of the gospel, which is about universal grace and mercy offered to all. This frustration isn't because I necessarily disagree with the positions these colleagues take. I frequently do, probably the majority of them. But because this approach elides the central point of the gospel for what I take to be the gospel's moral implications. And whenever it becomes about how good I am at being good, how moral I am, I know I'm a Jew. The love Jesus has for the rich man, and his subsequent statement that salvation is impossible if dependent on human effort, but that all things are possible with God, is a necessary antidote to the sort of moralism which will always make us see ourselves as inadequate. Second, Andy reminded me that While the rich young ruler left Jesus in sorrow because of what his command would mean, we never find out what he actually ends up doing. Like I said, the church fathers I consulted hadn't picked up on this possibility. They all assumed that this was a hopeless case. He was too tied to his own wealth to be obedient to Jesus' command and thus remained unjustified. But we just don't know whether that's the case or not. It's entirely possible that further down the line, he did end up selling all his possessions and giving the money to the poor. His initial reaction does not necessarily logically imply what he's going to do later. I'm not proud to admit this, but sometimes when I know I have to do something that I don't want to do, I get irritable and even sulky. But then I do the thing. And 99 times out of 100, I actually end up enjoying it and feeling gratified for having done it. Perhaps as a hopeful people, we should also hope that this happened to the rich young ruler. Now, there is an important caveat. No, we don't earn our way into heaven, no matter how charitable we are. That said, sometimes things like wealth can shield one from appreciating his or her need to rely on Jesus. Sometimes we can adopt what I've termed in sermons here before a false soteriology. That is a belief, whether explicit or more often implicit and functional, that something else is going to save us. Maybe it's wealth. Maybe it's the esteem of our fellows. Maybe it's even our own good works, which might fool us into thinking that we've reached perfection and don't need Jesus anymore. In any event, all these things can become what a pop psychologist might call baggage. And carrying that stuff around with us may cause us some sorrow too when we behold the narrow gate and recognize that we are like a heavily laden camel who must be unloaded to have any prayer of getting through the needle's eye. Forgive my mixed method here. I'm frequently reminded, because I need a lot of reminders, that I carry around some baggage, just like the rich young ruler. And I need to be ready to hold on to all of those things loosely enough that I can let it go if Jesus ever asked me to. We all do. Though what we happen to be carrying around might be radically different from individual to individual. So I want to give you my own uncomfortable personal confession along these lines. I seem to be doing that a lot lately, perhaps because after 8 years here, most of you more or less know me, and I more or less trust all of you, so I can be a bit confessional. Perhaps you can relate, and perhaps you can't, but I encourage you to consider what the equivalent is in your life. So, I am comfortable, for which I'm very grateful, but I'm not wealthy. God called me to a vocation in which that doesn't really happen. I might sometimes be surprised by how much some of my colleagues in fancy, endowed, historic parishes are paying. But thank God, we don't have the problem in our system that, say, a non-denominational megachurches with celebrity pastors face. My colleagues and I are all sorts of varying degrees of middle class, the only exceptions being those who inherit generational wealth. I am reminded, though, of a point sociologists have been making for a long time, which is that class has a lot to do with things other than money. Education, manners, a literary or artistic taste, whether or not someone's engaged in civic organizations, and so on and so forth. That being the case, I am sometimes given the painful reminder that I went to a fancy private East Coast liberal arts college. I read highbrow fiction, and I enjoy highbrow art, and as some of you know, for goodness sake, I even subscribe to the New Yorker. I don't have a distinctive regional accent, despite having grown up in Arkansas. I buy organic food. I could go on and on. I went to Toledo twice last week. The first time was for a lecture by the New York Times columnist David Brooks, whom I've been reading for decades. The second was to hear our favorite opera singer, Renee Fleming, at the Parasol, accompanied by the Toledo Symphony Orchestra. The last time we heard Ms. Fleming was on our honeymoon. It was at Carnegie Hall, and she was accompanied by the New York Philharmonic. So, I might not be wealthy, but to use language which has become popular in certain circles, I recognize my privilege. So what if life and circumstances meant that I had to give some or all of that up in some tangible way? What if the Holy Spirit drove me into some wilderness, say a parish in the middle of Alaska? I'm not going to a parish in the middle of Alaska, don't worry. But what if that happens? You never know with the Holy Spirit. Maybe I will. But what if that happened? Some place where the benefits of the sort of life to which I've become accustomed were either unavailable or completely alienating to the community in which I found myself. I'm sure at first my countenance would fall and I'd go off sorrowing, just like the rich young ruler. But what would I do next? I hope, I pray, that I'm holding on to all of those things, things that are perfectly good in and of themselves, but holding on to all of those things loosely enough that I could let them go for the sake of the gospel if I had to. But as ever, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. So I won't really know until I'm actually confronted with such a reality. So I think I have to rely on that first surprising insight about Jesus and the rich young ruler, which my wife turned me on to, that Jesus, looking on him, loved him. I need to place my hope entirely on the fact that the Lord God didn't come in the flesh in order to trick or test us, but to love us, and ask only that we try to love it in return. Eventually, we will lose all of that baggage, whether we're holding on to it tightly or loosely, because, spoiler alert, we're all going to die. And then what will great wealth, or the esteem of our fellows, or the fact that one has refined enough taste to even have a favorite opera singer to begin with, be worth? At that moment, the only thing we'll have is Jesus. But how wonderful it would be if we were prepared to have nothing but Jesus to get by with in this life before that final moment. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand. sacraments and other ministries.
For all who serve God and His Church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. We continue to pray for those affected by Hurricane Helene and for those affected by Hurricane Milton. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who die, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us,
most merciful Father, in your compassion forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone, and so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in the newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and a sacrifice.
Thank you.
singing, and we'll sing the song juice with them again.
All this we ask of your Son, Jesus Christ.
for the people of God. Spirit be among you, and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.